after that introduction, I'm going to talk to you now about the rules and regulations of discus. So the first thing I'm going to talk about is the actual discus itself. So the discus can be made from any material such as wood, but it must have a metallic rim. The discus can be hollow or solid. The discus must have a cross section of the edge. The cross section of the edge, sorry, should be made of a circular manner, and it must have a radius of 6 millimeters. All sides should be identical and should be free from irregularities. And the finishing of the discus should be smooth. The field itself, that's what I'm going to talk about next. So the first thing is the discus circle. The discus circle is 2.5 meters in radius. Around the discus circle is a cage, and the cage is in a U-shape. This cage is made out of a mesh, and the mesh should be able to withstand 2 kg of force and traveling at 25 meters per second. Next, the throwing circle, or the discus circle, is 6 millimeters deep into the ground. So there's a 6 millimeter step from inside to outside. The thrower's foot is allowed to touch the side of the step or the edge of the step, but not allowed to touch the top of it, which will be outside of the discus circle. The boundary lines are in a sector, so they come out from the discus circle in a kind of V shape. And the angle of this is 34.92 degrees. Finally, I'm going to talk about the throw itself. So the thrower must stay inside the circle while throwing. The thrower is allowed to enter from any side of the circle, but he must exit, he or she must exit from the back half of the circle. The discus must land within the boundary lines. If the discus lands on the boundary lines, it is counted as invalid. And when measuring the throw is measured from the closest part of the discus circle, but the measuring tape must go through the center of the discus circle in order to have the most accurate measurement. So now I'm going to talk about the 10 technical aspects of the discus. So the first one's going to be grip. And when you're gripping the discus, you use the crease in the top of your fingers that goes over the edges of the discus, and the thumb stays on the top. The momentum you use spinning is what keeps the discus in your hand. Next is the release. You release the discus off your index finger. Next is your throwing arm. The throwing arm should be at 90 degrees at all times, and it should be straight at the wrist and elbow. Next is the non-throwing arm. The non-throwing arm is similar to the throwing arm. It's about at 90 degrees, and it's used to keep the thrower on balance. Next is the torso. So the torso twists towards whichever side you throw from. So if you throw with your left arm, you twist left. If you twist with your right arm, you twist right. Next is your legs. Your legs are used to create momentum. So with your back leg, you push off, and then with the same leg, you swing, which helps you rotate quicker and create momentum to throw the discus. Next is your feet and your footwork. So footwork is very important in discus because you need to be able to pivot on the ball to your foot at high speeds in a small amount of space. So the discus circle is only 2.5 meters. In diameter, and you need to be very precise with your footwork because you don't have a lot of room to work with. Next is your shoulders, which again is very important. You need to be mobile and agile, mobile and flexible in this joint because you need a large range of motion to create power to throw the discus far. Next is your hips. Your hips work along with your feet to create momentum by a slight flexion of the hips and an extension when pushing off. Next is posture. So your posture should be up straight, your spine should be straight for the whole throw, the only bend should be at your hips, as I just mentioned. And finally, the follow through. So the follow through is split into two categories. There's the spin and there's the block. The spin is after releasing the discus, you continue spinning, and the block is when you release the discus and you come to an abrupt stop. Okay, The spin is more common because it's easier and it's more natural, whereas the block is less common but has been seen to be used by better athletes such as Robert Harding, who is the 2012 Olympic gold medalist, and Jürgen Schlott, who is the men's discus world record holder.
Dylan starts to throw with the feet facing sideways. He brings his throwing arm back and has the discus held vertically. He performs a 520 degree turn and jumps between the pivots. The discus was released with the throwing arm at 90 degrees and the discus was rolled off the index finger when releasing. His left foot was planted on the ground and the right foot followed through the swing, making slight contact with the ground. Here we can see his knees at a slight bend. We also see that his throwing arm is angled slightly higher than 90 degrees. Again, we see the follow through with the right foot, and the throwing arm can also be seen following through the swing across his body. We clearly see that both feet leave the ground, showing that he jumped between pivots in the spin. Gavin starts with his feet facing sideways, throwing arm by his side. He doesn't jump between the pivots in his spin. Again, his feet are facing sideways. The discus is gripped in a vertical position. Again, there is no jump between the pivots in the spin. His throwing arm is behind the body at less than 90 degrees. The following foot is off the ground upon release. Here we can see that the non-throwing arm is being kept at 90 degrees for balance. The discus is released by rolling off the index finger with the throwing arm at 90 degrees. His torso is kept in line and his posture is vertical. He steps outside the ring after the release of the discus.
After we sat down and discussed, we concluded our aims for fitness testing were going to be muscular strength, power, and flexibility. In order to achieve this, we needed to create a training program for our athlete. To test muscular strength, we did grip test. For power, we did the med ball toss. And for flexibility, we did the shoulder flexibility test. For our training, we had our athlete do 3 gym sessions a week, along with at least 2 mobility sessions. Our gym sessions focused on upper body workouts, attacking muscle groups such as your shoulders and chest. We also worked a lot on core and rotary power. For flexibility, we wanted to increase shoulder mobility. This will increase the range of motion of the shoulder joint. As well as this, we wanted our athlete to gain weight. The heavier you are, the easier it is to throw a discus. With the proper gym routine and nutrition, it was possible to put on weight in a healthy manner. Through fitness testing before and after, we were able to see major improvements in our athlete.
Gavin's strengths were that on release, Gavin's arm is at 90 degrees and he has his wrist tilted up to allow for the discus to fly upwards at an optimal angle. Gavin's grip of the discus is correct and allows him to let the discus roll off his index finger upon release. Gavin's posture is also good throughout his throws and he keeps his torso in a straight line, which allows him to turn with more power and drive through his swing more. He also keeps his knees at a slight bend to generate momentum and shift his weight easily. His non-throwing arm is used well to balance throughout the spin and is often kept at roughly 90 degrees to his torso. Gavin's weaknesses were that, number one, in his starting position, his feet are often facing sideways instead of facing away from the target. This will give less time to the throw and will ultimately slow the throw down and reduce the force generated from the technique. His second weakness was that his wrist is not kept straight in line with his throwing arm throughout the throwing technique, which leads to a loss in discus control and can affect the momentum or force generated from the throwing technique. His third weakness was that his throwing arm is often held out at less than 90 degrees to his torso and is not stretched back far enough and is usually kept in line with his body. This will hamper the momentum gathered from the spin and will make the throw less powerful. Gavin's fourth weakness was that his footwork is often messy and leads to ring outs after release due to only having one foot on the ground and not being balanced enough to prevent the throw's momentum from dragging him out of the ring. His fifth and final weakness was that the lack of a jump in the middle of his spin led to a serious lack of speed and force generated in the throwing technique, leading to less power generated for his throw.
For drill one, the purpose of this drill is to work on my footwork. In discus, footwork is extremely important as you need to be able to pivot at high speeds in a small amount of space. For the drill, we set up three cones 1.25 meters apart, so the two outside cones are 2.5 meters apart, the same as the discus circle. I start between two cones and push off my outside foot, swinging my leg around to create momentum. Next, I push my pivot foot, which creates the hop. Now my first leg becomes the pivot foot and I swing the other leg around, continuing the momentum. After doing a 360 turn, I land back in my original stance. So by the end of this drill, my coaches felt that I was doing the movement very well and correctly. And the only complaint they had was that I could have increased the pace, or they could have put more pressure on me to do the movement a bit quicker, because they felt that I've already progressed to the level that I was working at. For drill two, the purpose of this drill is to work on my upper body mechanics and my release. Releasing the discus at the right time is something that I've always struggled with. For this drill, I'm going to stand with my 2 feet facing forward in the same position as I would when I finish my throw, with my 2 feet planted in the ground. Because my legs are planted, this isolates the upper body, forcing my arms and torso to do all the work. After doing this drill, my coaches felt that I improved a lot, and they think that my upper body mechanics got a lot better, a lot more solid, and my timing got a lot better. One thing I found difficult when throwing at the start was my release timing. So a lot of the time I would throw the discus out of bounds, and that'd be an invalid throw. So what this did was it helped me work on my release angles, as well as the discus rolling off my index finger, which really helped with accuracy and precision.